My name is Dr. Yutika Sirohi. I have cleared my national boards part one and part two recently. And today I'm going to be teaching anatomy of the upper limb. The way we are going to approach is the sound and the video clear? Can I proceed? Please just type if it's clear. Is sound check, is the audio clear? If it's clear, then I'll just go ahead with the, all right, great. So we're going to be doing anatomy of the upper limb, and we're going to start with the skeletal anatomy, that is osteology, the bones in, the bones of the upper limb. Then we will go on to the muscles and the blood vessels. Finally, we'll do nerves. Now, the nerves are very, very, very high yield because this will mainly include your brachial plexus and applied anatomy of brachial plexus, which is very high yield for your national boards. And of course, the type of joints in the upper limb. The way to remember, like for national boards or for dentists, the high yield points will be to know osteology, just basic stuff about the bones, as in their attachments, any major muscle which is attaching, and the surface landmarks. For the muscles, if you all know the name, it's enough. Not really important to know their attachments. It's just enough to know the names of the muscles, particularly the hand and the forearm. The vessels, again, are not a very high yield. The arteries and veins are not very high yield. The most high yield topic in the upper limb is your nerves, because we'll be studying brachial plexus in detail, and it's applied anatomy as well. For the joints of the upper limb, you need to know the nature or the classification of each joint. So starting with, of course, you know, when you study the upper limb, you divide it into shoulder. Then extending from your shoulder to your elbow is the arm. From your elbow to wrist is forearm. Then this portion is your hand. And of course, axilla and breast, which is a part of the appendicular skeleton, which may be included later. So starting with the bones of the shoulder, there are two bones in the shoulder, your clavicle and scapula. Now, both these bones are going to be articulating with the sternum medially. That the sternum is a part of rib cage, and your humerus, the bone of the arm. So we'll start with your scapula. As you can see, scapula is a triangular shaped flat bone. The common name for this bone is shoulder blade. And you can see in this picture that this is articulating laterally with humerus, where it forms the glenohumeral joint, that is the shoulder joint or the glenohumeral joint. And medially, this is the acromion process, is articulating with the clavicle. So this is your this portion, this is your clavicle, and this is your humerus. I'm just writing it so that just for clarity. And this triangular platform is your scapula. Now, when we study the anatomy of scapula, as you can see, it's a triangular bone. It has two surfaces, ventral surface facing the front and a posterior surface. So out here, we can, in this picture, we can see the ventral surfaces. Then it has, you don't need to know, really, this is just for basic information. There won't be any questions about surfaces and all. You don't really need to mug up the osteology of these bones. You just need to, probably just go through them once so that you're aware, in case there's one odd question, you're able to answer it. You really don't need to know how many angles are there and all. Mainly, you need to just know what all the bone is articulating with and important bony landmarks. So, as you can see, it's a triangular shaped bone. So, there are three angles. There is a superior angle, lateral angle, a superior angle, lateral angle, and an inferior angle. Then it has three borders, again because it's a triangular shape. It has a medial border, this is a medial border, then it has a lateral border and a superior border. The important, now this point is important. If you see, now the bony landmarks, or you can say the important landmarks is that posteriorly, when you see the posterior surface, scapula has a spine which divides your scapula into supraspinous and infraspinous spinous fossa, and you have a coracoid and acromion process. So if you see this acromion process, this is the, you know, this bone here is your clavicle. So, you know, this is like the posterior vision. This can be your spine of the scapula. It is dividing the scapula posteriorly into supraspinatus fossa. This is your supraspinatus fossa. Inferior to the spine is your infraspinatus fossa. And where it is articulating with the clavicle, you have your, this process is your acromion process. I'm just writing it for clarity. So the joint is known as acromioclavicular joint. We'll be just seeing it in a little more detail. The ventral surface is, you know, concave, and mainly it gives to it's a concave depression, and it's known as your subcapsular fossa. And mainly it gives origin to your subcapsularis muscle. So just you don't need to remember the name of the muscle or anything. You just need to know that ventrally it is, if you see, this is the dorsal surface, so this will be the ventral surface. Ventrally it's shallow concave shaped depression, subcapsularis fossa, or it gives attachment to subcapsularis muscle. The dorsal surface, as we saw, the spine, there is a spine which is dividing it into supraspinatus and infraspinatus fossa. Again, the name of the fossa, the name of the muscle, supraspinatus fossa will give attachment to supraspinatus muscle. Infraspinatus fossa will give attachment to infraspinatus muscle. These attachments are not very important, but if you just read it carefully once, you should be enough. It should be enough, and you can then just go on to your decks and questions. The only thing which you need to revisit again and again in upper limb is your brachial plexus. Okay. Then the spine of the scapula, basically, again, let's just look at this picture. The spine of the scapula is continuing your acromion process, where the scapula is articulating with the clavicle, forming the acromion clavicular joint, is just continuation of your spine of the scapula. So you know what the thing is, if you have a nice osteology atlas, you just, you know, correlate with picture and just go through it once. So the spine of the scapula starts medially to extend laterally, where it becomes to, it can basically, it continues as the acromial process, where it will articulate with the clavicle. Now, if you understand that the ventral surface of the scapula is facing your rib cage, it's the shoulder blade. The ventral surface is facing the rib cage. So the other term sometimes in questions will be your costal surface or spinal surface. So when they are saying costal surface, remember they are talking about the ventral surface of scapula. When they are talking about the spinal surface, they are talking about the posterior surface of the scapula. So on the ventral surface or costal surface, where it is facing the, you know, rib cage, you also have another process known as your coracoid process. Okay. Now, coracoid process is beneath your acromion process. And basically, as the name is suggesting, coracoid, it's here there is origin of your coracoid brachialis and biceps brachii. That is the importance of this process. So let's go back to the picture. So in this, you can just see about your acromion process just beneath it. Let me see if there's a picture here.